Assalamu alaikum everyone, welcome again to another ATP video. Today we'll be discussing another streptococcal species, so please welcome Streptococcus pyogenes. As usual, we will discuss its characteristics, important lab features, then we will talk about the toxins it produces, clinical importance, and the treatment. Now let's talk about the features of Streptococcus pyogenes. If you remember from our last video, we said that streptococci in general are gram-positive, catalase negative, and arranged in chains. Here is the full classification of streptococci, and this is S. pyogenes. By looking at this beautiful chart, we can safely say that Streptococcus pyogenes is beta hemolytic, bacitracin sensitive, which means it cannot survive in the presence of bacitracin, and PYR positive. PYR stands for pyrrolidinyl aminopeptidase enzyme. Keep in mind that these features are important because they allow you to identify this organism in the lab or in exam questions. In addition to that, Streptococcus pyogenes is also referred to as group A strep, GAS. Now, for the virulence factors, first, Streptococcus pyogenes has a capsule made of hyaluronic acid, as opposed to the polysaccharide capsule in most of the encapsulated bacteria, and that protects it from the macrophages. The second virulence factor is the M protein. It helps Streptococcus pyogenes evade the immune system, especially phagocytosis and the complement system. Now let's talk about the bad toxins of Streptococcus pyogenes. Streptococcus pyogenes has enzymes and toxins that contribute to its virulence, most importantly, streptolysin O enzyme and erythrogenic exotoxin A. Streptolysin O, from the lysin in its name, its function is to lyse cell membrane, RBCs for example. Therefore, the presence of this toxin makes Streptococcus pyogenes a beta hemolytic strep. In addition to that, our bodies generate antibodies against streptolysin O and DNA's enzyme of Streptococcus pyogenes. These anti-streptolysin and anti-DNA's antibodies can be measured, which aids in the diagnosis of Streptococcus pyogenes. The second toxin is erythrogenic exotoxin A. This is a super antigen, but what does that mean? This toxin can cross-link T-cell receptor to MHC2, apart from the binding site. This leads to constant activation of T-cells, leading to a storm of inflammatory cytokine release, cytokines such as IL-1, IL-2, interferon gamma. This can cause toxic shock-like syndrome and scarlet fever, which will be covered next. Please note that erythrogenic exotoxin A is similar to toxic shock syndrome toxin produced by Staph aureus, which we talked about in the Staph aureus video before, and can lead to toxic shock syndrome. Now, in regards to the clinical importance of Streptococcus pyogenes, it can cause many diseases in the human body, and for this reason, we will categorize these diseases caused by Streptococcus pyogenes based on the pathogenesis into three groups. And we're going to use this mnemonic for these three groups. It's a PIT. Pyogenic, immunogenic, and toxigenic. Pyogenic includes infections of the skin and mucous membranes, so pharyngitis, impetigo, erysipelas, and cellulitis. Pharyngitis is self-explanatory. It's characterized by red, swollen tonsils with purulent exudates, fever, and cervical lymphadenopathy. For the skin infections, first we have impetigo, which affects the upper layers of the epidermis. Then we have erysipelas, which affects the upper layers of the dermis and the superficial lymphatics. Lastly, we have cellulitis, which affects deeper layers of dermis and the subcutaneous tissue. To differentiate erysipelas from cellulitis on gross inspection, erysipelas is well demarcated and raised, whereas cellulitis is poorly demarcated. I know that might be a bit confusing, but here's a little trick. I eat cellulose. Impetigo, erysipelas, and cellulitis. In the same order, they affect the skin from the outermost to the innermost layer. Impetigo is most superficial, erysipelas is deeper, and cellulitis is the deepest among them. Going back to the PIT, the second category is immunogenic, which includes rheumatic fever and glomerulonephritis. Rheumatic fever is a big topic on its own, but simply put, it happens due to molecular mimicry. Antibodies against M protein of Streptococcus pyogenes are produced, which can also attack cardiac proteins such as myosin, which leads to rheumatic fever. To diagnose it, we can use the Jones criteria, which is J for joint, which is in the form of migratory polyarthritis, the O, which is similar to a heart, so carditis, N for nodules in the skin, which are subcutaneous, E for erythema marginatum, which is an evanescent rash, which means it disappears quickly, with a ring margin, and lastly S for sydenham chorea. Since it's caused by antibodies attacking the heart directly, it's a type 2 hypersensitivity. Glomerulonephritis, on the other hand, is a type 3 hypersensitivity, wherein immunocomplexes result in inflammatory response and glomerular damage. Clinically, patients will present with edema in the face and darker urine, which is tea or cola colored due to the presence of RBCs in the urine. It's important to note that rheumatic fever happens only after pharyngeal infection, whereas glomerulonephritis can happen after either skin or pharyngeal infections with Streptococcus pyogenes. Lastly, toxigenic, and it includes toxic shock-like syndrome and scarlet fever. Toxic shock-like syndrome is a serious condition which can lead to fever, rash, and shock. Scarlet fever results in three main problems: skin and mucous membranes involvement, in addition to fever. For the skin, it causes flushed cheeks but spares the area around the mouth, a pattern known as circumoral pallor. In addition to that, it causes a rough rash on the trunk and extremities, sometimes referred to as sandpaper-like rash. For the mucous membranes, it causes sore throat and strawberry tongue. As we mentioned before, these two toxigenic diseases are caused by erythrogenic exotoxin A. Lastly, necrotizing fasciitis is also classified under toxigenic, and this is a surgical emergency. It causes necrosis of the deeper layers of the skin and might be accompanied with crepitus and bullae formation. Finally, for the treatment and prophylaxis of Streptococcus pyogenes, penicillin can be used to treat it, and it can also be used as prophylaxis in cases of rheumatic fever. For those with penicillin allergy, don't worry, we can use macrolides as an alternative treatment. Of course, there are more details about this, but we wanted to keep it short and simple. Now let's sum it up. Streptococcus pyogenes is a gram-positive, beta-hemolytic, catalase-negative organism. It's bacitracin-sensitive and PYR-positive. It can cause diseases by three main mechanisms: pyogenic, immunogenic, and toxigenic. Pyogenic, remember infections of the skin and mucous membranes. Immunogenic, remember rheumatic fever and glomerulonephritis. And toxigenic, remember toxic shock-like syndrome and scarlet fever. And lastly, keep your pen ready to write penicillin as a treatment of choice for Streptococcus pyogenes. And that's it for Streptococcus pyogenes, and it's time to say goodbye. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to receive our latest explanations, and as always, thanks for watching.